Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare Hare. Jagatguru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Let's offer our respects. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Let's recite the verses. Today is the last time we are going to recite this set. So those of you who like, you can close it down and you can and you can test your memory. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Maya Sakta Manaparta Yogam Yunjan Madashrayaha Ashamshayam Chamagramam Yatagnya Chashita Chrinu Mata Parataram Nanyad Kinchidasti Dananjaya Mai Sarvam Hidam Protam Shudre Mani Ganahiva Yam Yam Bapi Smaran Bhavam Tyaja Tante Kalevaram Tam Tam Yeva Iti Kaunteya Sadatad Bhava Bhavitaha Tasmat Sarveshu Kaleshu Ma Manushmara Yudhyacha Mai Sarvita Mano Buddhir Ma Me Vaishyasya Samsayaha Mahatmanastu Mam Partha Daivim Prakritim Ashritaha Bhajanti Ananya Manaso Nyatva Bhutadim Havyayam Ananyas Chintayanto Mam Ejana Paryupashate Tesham Nityabhi Yuktanam Yogakshemam Vahamyaham Yatkaroshi Yadashnashi Yajuhoshi Dadasiyat Yattapasyasi Kaunteya Tatkurushva Madarpanam Shipram Bhavati Dharmatma Shashvat Santim Nigachati Kaunteya Pratijanehi Name Bhakta Pranashyati Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo Matha Sarvam Pravartate Iti Matva Bhajante Mam Bhuta Bhava Samanvitaha Machitta Matgata Prana Bodhayanta Parasparam Katayantascha Mam Nityam Tushyanti Cha Ramanti Cha Tesham Satata Yuktanam Bhajatam Priti Purvakam Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam Yenamam Upayantite Tesham Evam Nukampartam Aham Hagyana Jamtamaha Nashayami Atma Bhavasto Jnana Dipena Bhashvataha Matkarma Krin Matparamo Madbhakta Sangavarjitaha Nirvaira Sarva Bhuteshu Yasamameti Pandava Tesham Tantvani Karmani Mai Sanyasya Matparaha Ananyenaiva Yogena Mam Dhyayanta Upasate Teshamaham Samudharta Mrityu Samsara Sagarat Bhavami Nachirat Partha Maya Veshita Chetasam Mayeva Mana Adatsva Mai Buddhim Niveshayaha Nivashishyashi Mayeva Ata Urdvam Nasamshayaha. Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and engage all your intelligence in me. Thus you will live in me always without a doubt. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna. It's 10:20 now. We'll finish the class around 11:30 or 11:35. I'll take 5-10 minutes more this week. We are finishing chapter 18. Some of you who were watching video last week, they sent me text messages that the first 10 minutes from last week's class was missing. Sometimes, you know, you go to a vantage point to take a nice photo, you get an angle, you get the range, and you click. Of all the photos, that's the only one that comes out blurry. So the entire class, I give the summary in first 10 minutes, and that alone was missing. So I thought I'll quickly run you through. So for those of you who attended, it's a revision, and for those of you who haven't, this is what you missed. So in chapter 16, Krishna spoke about the divine and demoniac natures. And towards the end of chapter 16, one most defining characteristic of a person endowed with divine qualities and one most defining characteristic of a person endowed with demoniac qualities is those who are divine, they'll follow the scriptures, and those who are demoniac, they won't. Now, we saw how those who have faith in the scriptures, they are divine. And those who don't, Krishna says, that's a demoniac characteristic. However, Arjuna opens chapter 17 by asking Krishna about those people who fall under a category wherein they have faith, they follow strictly, but those faith doesn't necessarily have to be based on scriptures. Okay, that could be based on a tradition, that could be based on one's own sentiment, could be a number of reasons for that. Where do they fall under? So this is how Arjuna opens the chapter in chapter 17, actually. To answer that, Krishna then elaborates on the different characteristics, different symptoms which one can actually have, possibly, in these different modes of nature. Now, because the most fundamental defining character is faith. When the faith, as long as it's based on scriptures, bhakti scriptures, that faith becomes transcendental or spiritual. But the same faith, if it's not based on any scriptures, it becomes influenced by one of the three modes. So there is goodness, there is passion, and there is ignorance. And Prabhupada says that one's faith depends on one's heart. Okay, the faith is wherever one's subtle body is. So wherever we are reposing our heart in, that's exactly how our faith is going to be influenced. Now Krishna, after saying this, that faith can be of three types, goodness, passion and ignorance. Krishna says, because faith is something subtle, something which is abstract, it's very hard for us to gauge what faith a person has. So in order to understand what faith a person has, Krishna says we can study that by some symptoms. And as a case study, Krishna says, depending on the type of food a person takes, you can actually understand what faith he is in. Depending on the type of sacrifice he does, austerity and charity. So if a person has faith in mode of goodness, he would eat a certain type of food. A person in who is actually following his passion, he'd actually come eat certain type of food, same way. Person through ignorance, he'll actually have eat a certain type of food. So on and so forth. The same way sacrifice, austerity and charity, as we discussed in the previous chapter. Now the relationship between faith and this one is, each of these aspects, if you analyze it closely, it takes a certain amount of faith to follow a certain sacrifice because none of them yield instant result. So there is a certain amount of faith that's actually involved. Even if you give charity, you can give, you know, $10 to somebody. How is that going to be reciprocated to you? You don't know. So there is a certain amount of faith that's involved. So same way, austerity. You may do fasting, but you don't know how you're going to actually get repaid back. So same way with sacrifice, same way with even food, for that matter. So that's the relationship between this whole dynamics here. Then we also just touched on the different sections of the chapter. So verse 1 to 7, it covered faith and worship, where we saw in a person in mode of goodness, he'll worship the demigods, person in mode of passion. Who do they worship? Demons, people in mode of ignorance. Okay, ghosts and spirits, and we discussed quite a lot there. So there is pretas there. As soon as you are dead, for 13 days you'll actually have a body called preta, not you, the person who's dead. And then after the 13th day, the preta becomes prita, pitraloka rather, pitra. And then from there it goes to pitraloka. And to be able to maintain our forefathers in there, then that's when you actually do the pindadana and everything. You need to do the shat ceremony to maintain them there. So that's what was discussed in verse 1 to 7. 8 to 10 discussed on food. 11 to 13 sacrifice. 14 to 19 yajna, tapa. Tapa is austerity. And then 20 to 22 charity. And then 23 to 28. So we discussed 1 to 7, it spoke about different types of faith, different people's mode of worship, depending on whatever material mode of nature they are influenced by. Same as with food. 11 to 13, we discussed on sacrifice in each of the different modes. 14 to 19, we discussed on austerity. And we also discussed on how Krishna first defines there are three types of austerity. Austerity of the body and speech. And then Krishna was saying how each one of them can be influenced by modes. Austerity of the body can be in each of the three different modes, so on and so forth. 20 to 22, Krishna discussed about charity. We saw how in Vedic scriptures it's actually given, what proportion you actually get in return. But those who actually give any charity to Veda Paraga, or a self-realized soul or devotees, it comes back to them unlimitedly, both materially and spiritually. Each one of these, even though they are without injunctions, they are not strictly chaste to following the scriptures, scriptural injunctions. Nevertheless, it's still a good entry point for them to come in touch with the transcendence. How do they do? Simply by every time they actually do any of these activities, if they actually chant Om Tat Sat, that's like their entry point to start chanting the holy name of the Lord, because Om Tat Sat refers to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Simply by doing that, slowly they will elevate themselves to come to the platform of transcendence, and from there, they'll go to spiritual world. So that's the idea. So this is what you missed in first 10 minutes. All right, Moksha Yoga. We'll get liberated from Bhagavad Gita today. So that's chapter 18, the perfection of renunciation. Technically, there is no connection between chapter 17 and 18. Usually, at the start of every chapter, we see how the previous chapter is actually leading to this one. Prabhupada writes in the purport that technically, Bhagavad Gita finished in 17 chapters itself. 18 is just a conclusion or a wrap-up, which Krishna actually gives. So there is no direct connection. So Arjuna puts a generic question at the start of 18th chapter. We'll go to that shortly. So that's Moksha Yoga. This is the longest chapter in Bhagavad Gita, has 78 verses, and we have an hour. We need to do sprinting now. So on a high level, the way how this is laid out, if you read the summary itself can be slightly bewildering, but there is a nice structure there. We'll go through that shortly. But overall layout on a bird's eye view for this chapter is verse 1 to 12, it speaks on karma section. Specifically in that chapter 1 to 6. Now you will see the genius of Krishna. He will touch on each and every aspect which he has been discussing since 213 rather, all the way till end of 17th chapter. Every single aspect he actually touched on, you will find a relevant verse in this particular chapter. So verse 1 to 12 is a summary of the first 6 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. 13 to 18, it's on the jnana section or yoga of knowledge. So that is chapter technically 13 to 17. 18 also includes jnana. So in summary, it's actually given as 13 to 18. 19 to 40, we actually see It discusses on karma, how each of the different activities that we do in this world, it's actually influenced by different modes. That section alone, if you read your summary, it may be slightly confusing. We'll come to that elaborately when we go there. So then 41 to 48, it discusses on Nishkama Karma Yoga, or from Sakama to Nishkama. So this is Sakama, so this is... Nishkama Karma Yoga, 49 to 55, it discusses on a transition from Nishkama Karma Yoga, goes all the way to knowledge or jnana, to Brahman platform or liberation, and ultimately to devotional service. 56 to 60. It discusses on working in pure devotional service. DS is devotional service. 61 to 63. Surrendering to super soul. Four to 66 talks on pure devotional service or surrender to the Supreme Lord, surrender to Krishna. Then 67 to 71, then 72 to 73, 74 to 78. So 67 to 71 speaks on studying and preaching Bhagavad Gita. 72 to 73, Arjuna is now fixed in his mind to fight. 74 to 78, Sanjaya's predictions. So that's 18th chapter altogether. So verse 1 to 12, it speaks on summary of the first 6 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. 13 to 18, it speaks on the jnana section, especially chapters 13 to 18. 19 to 40, it speaks on karma, executing karma in this material world. How our activity, every action is actually influenced by so many, different modes. So that's what 19 to 40 section, but there are about 6 factors there, actually 6 factors that Krishna discusses on. 41 to 48, Krishna speaks on Sakama to Nishkama Karma Yoga. That's where Krishna would discuss on the 4 Varnas, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, how one should execute their occupational duty. 49 to 55, Krishna will discuss on how Nishkama Karma Yoga, if we continue to do that, then it will lead to knowledge, and then eventually that will elevate one to come to the platform of Brahman, wherein one is no longer influenced by the modes, and then we can go back to the spiritual world by engaging in devotional service. 56 to 60 speaks on working in pure devotional service. 61 to 63, surrendering to the super soul. Now this section, Nishkama to Jnana to Brahman. So this is confidential knowledge, 49 to 55. Prabhupada explains that is confidential knowledge. 61 to 63 is more confidential knowledge. And then 64 to 66 is most confidential knowledge. Because one deals with Brahman, this one deals with Paramatma, and this one deals with Krishna, the Supreme Lord. So this is another definition which Prabhupada actually gives. That knowledge which actually deals with the all-pervading aspect of the Supreme Lord, Brahman, that's confidential. That which deals with the super soul or Paramatma, that is more confidential. And that which deals with Krishna, that's most confidential. 67 to 71, Krishna tells what benefits we actually get by studying and preaching this message of Bhagavad Gita to everyone. 72 to 73, Arjuna, after having heard all the 18 chapters, he gives his conclusion, what his understanding is, and then 74 to 78, Sanjaya does predictions about, because remember Bhagavad Gita started with, after my sons and sons of Pandu assembled in place of pilgrimage, what did they do? For that question, Sanjaya answered in 700 verses. And finally he concludes, by the way, your sons stand no chance. He just concludes that. So this is chapter 18 called Moksha Yoga or Perfection of Renunciation. Any questions in this? Yes. Yes. Yeah. If you see chapter, good question. Chapter 1 to 6, even though we actually speak on different levels, like third chapter speaks on karma, for karma yoga, fourth chapter speaks on jnana yoga, then fifth chapter we see action in Krishna consciousness again, sixth is again ashtanga yoga. Even though we are in one sense saying there are different types of yoga, each one of the yoga actually involves the performer to do some activity. He's not renouncing and giving up and going to the forest. It's not like that. So they all, on a high level, still comes under karma only. But karma, ashtanga yoga, who performs ashtanga yoga, he goes to the forest and there he... Somebody in jnana platform, somebody in different platform. That's what happens. Okay, so that's karma section. Whereas here, the analysis is totally on, you take an activity per se, any action in this world. And Krishna actually in 40th verse, he says even demigods are not exempt from this. Even they are influenced by modes. So this is just an analysis of the action itself per se. Whereas this is a summary of the first six chapters. So this is a spin-off from here again. But if this one comes from, because in 13 to 18, Krishna deals with the jnana section. So this is a spin-off from there actually. He just picks up karma and elaborates on here before going back to the analysis of the flow of yoga. Like that. Any other question? Yeah, that BG is Bhagavad Gita. Yeah. Okay, so now we can go section by section. This chapter, because it's so big, even I think it's more than 60 pages or something, if you read, it won't confuse you. It's just the volume of information is more, but this is one of the most easiest chapters. If you see, most of the purports are very, very small, actually. So if you read twice or thrice, especially with the summary, you will remember it like a story. Even verse numbers you can remember like a story. Okay, so section, first section 1 to 12. Arjuna opens the chapter by asking two main questions. He's asking Krishna, so what's your opinion on renunciation? And the renounced order. Technically, renunciation is called Tyaga, and renounced order is Sannyasa. So this is the question Arjuna asks in the first verse of 18th chapter. What's the difference, or how are they two related? Are they the same, or are they different? In answer to this question, Krishna actually says they both are the same. Why are they same? Sannyasa means they stop working completely. Stop working, especially material activities, they completely stop. Whereas renunciation, tyaga, means they do activity, however they are detached to the fruits. Now in terms of reaction, if you see, one person doesn't do any work at all, technically. The other person does a work, but is not attached to results. In other words, both of them, they do no action. So Krishna says, they both are the same. However, to give up everything and going to the forest, remember Krishna actually says, a soul by nature is very, very active. It can't keep quiet even for a moment. So Krishna actually draws parallel between these two by saying, one doesn't do work, the other one actually does work, but he is detached to the fruits. He doesn't take any effect of the activity at all. So in essence, neither of them do any action. Reaction giving action, neither of them do. So Krishna says they both are the same. However, Krishna encourages Arjuna to go for this. The first six chapters, it's all based on this one only. Wherein you still do. It could be Ashtanga Yoga, could be Karma Yoga, could be Jnana Yoga. You do, but be detached to the results. That's one common denominator across all types of yoga, including bhakti yoga, if you actually see. Yoga means you connect with Krishna, but try to be detached to the results, basically. So that's the idea. So Krishna says they both are the same. And then Krishna extends it further and saying there are three activities which should never be shunned, even by people in renounced order. Yajna, dana and tapa. Or yajna means sacrifice. Dana means charity. And tapa means austerity. Krishna says these three should not be shunned by anybody, including those in the renounced order of life. Why? Because they purify. If you look at Durga, you know what a trident is? Akhileshwar can do a much better job, but that's a trident. So Durga holds a trident, and the trident actually represents three types of miseries that everyone has to go through in this world. Okay, they are called Adhyatmik, Adhibhautik, and Adhidevik. Those miseries that are caused by one's mind, those miseries that are caused by other people, those miseries that are caused by demigods. There is a direct correlation between these three with each one of them. By doing sacrifice, we can counteract Adhidevik miseries or miseries that are caused by demigods. By giving charity, you can counteract Adhibhautik or miseries that are caused by other living entities. By doing austerity, we can control the mind, so we can protect ourselves from our own mind. So that's the correlation between sacrifice, charity, and austerity to the three miseries. So as long as we keep doing these three, we have to keep doing yajna, nama yajna. We studied even in third chapter, annat bhavanti bhutani parjanyat anna sambhava. By doing sacrifice, we can please the demigods, and them being pleased, they'll give the rain. Prabhupada actually writes. So that comes under sacrifice or yajna, adhidevik, to the demigods. But as devotees, we don't need to go to demigods, we directly please the Supreme Lord, simply by chanting Hare Krishna. So that's same with dana. Prabhupada says, everyone who is born in this world, you take something from this world, you have to give something back. But if you give it for a Krishna conscious purpose, then Prabhupada says your life becomes perfect. So dana, it counteracts adhibhautik. By giving charity to other people, we become friendly to other living entities, and other living entities also becomes very friendly with us. So same way with tapa, by doing austerity, we actually bring the mind to a peaceful state, and we can maintain ourselves at that level. And it is very important for us to continue doing this. These three activities, Krishna says, even people in renounced order, they should not give up. So this is about this section, the crux of this section actually. Any questions on this? None of these concepts are new. It's just a recap of whatever we discussed before, but it's just a summary. Krishna puts it in slightly different words in some places, but the concepts are all the same as what we discussed before. Next is section 13 to 18. We discuss on jnana. So if you open your book. So we go to 14th verse. This is like the seed verse that explains the whole section. It's a very simple verse basically. What Krishna is saying in this verse is, every action that we do in this world, we'll quickly read the verse. The place of action, the body, the performer, the various senses, the many different kinds of effort, and ultimately the super soul. These are the five factors of action. Jnana, working in knowledge, means to understand we are not the controller. So that's the primary basic knowledge actually we need to know. If somebody is in knowledge, means they understand that they don't control everything. Now, if we say we don't control everything, then the question that comes is, who is controlling it? So Krishna is saying, for any action, if you understand this particular point, you will understand the next 22 verses. Any action, it is actually controlled by five different factors. One is body. Second is Atisthanam, Karta, Doer, Karanam, Senses, Chesta, Endeavor. And then Daiva, which is Supreme. So this is the crux of this section. Basically what this section is teaching us is, Krishna is saying, any activity that you actually do in this world, it is actually controlled by five different things. It's dependent on five different factors. It is depending on the kshetra, or the body that is actually doing the activity, the actual doer, which is the soul, the senses, that's the vaya media with which you actually do the action, then endeavor, the actual action itself. But most important cause is the Supreme. Prabhupada says, of all the five, this is the most important cause. This is the most efficient cause. Prabhupada uses the word efficient cause. So a person in knowledge means, after understanding, studying all this knowledge, he will come to the conclusion, he or she will come to the conclusion that, yes, there is only so much I can do. Endeavor is only 1/5 of the activity, right? So a person in knowledge means, he will understand that my endeavor, yeah, it plays a role, but only 1/5 of the actual outcome is controlled by my actual activity. By cultivating this knowledge, a person would naturally get detached. Because imagine if there is a, let's say there is a table that's actually given, I'm gifting it to five of you, and say all of you please enjoy this. And one person alone, four of them, they gang up against one, for example. The one person who wants to actually pull, after some time he let it go. He said, like, forget it. There's no point in fighting with them. I'll never be able to overcome them. Same way. A person, as long as he goes with this attached position, attached mood that, like, I'm here simply for enjoying whatever that's in this world, he'll try to control everything by manipulating things around. But once he comes to this knowledge, actually every single activity is actually based on these five. Prabhupada says, even to close your eyelid, there's a demigod that's in charge. Only when that demigod cooperates, Prabhupada is saying you can close. There are people with health condition who can't close, actually. Especially if you get a stroke or something, you can't really close. Okay, it doesn't cooperate. So it's, this knowledge is very powerful. You take any activity for that matter. Gokuleshwar Prabhu was giving this beautiful analogy. He says, let's say, suppose you have a glass object in your home and you're cleaning. Let's say your kid is actually playing around and the kid pushes the glass object, falls down, crashes into pieces. Then what do you do is, like, you'll bring the kid and you'll try to teach the kid, chastise. Again and again you'll keep on reminding the kid, you did that in the morning and then afternoon, maybe in the evening. Because so much as you are actually attached to that object, you will feel hurted. But then, let's say next day, I'll tell you about a scenario two. Scenario two is, you clean the home and by mistake you actually push it down. How many times will you actually think and chastise yourself? So he was saying, even if you want to slap yourself, it'll come like this. you won't really hit. Now, it's a simple analogy, but if you understand the moral of the story, is it has a very deep application. The idea here is that if we, in the first case, when we think the other person actually pushed an object down, something which you held very, very dear to you, you feel very hurted. Again and again and again, you are blaming him. Now, next day, same object, if you accidentally push down, you will just collect it, throw it in the bin, and you will move on. You are not going to, you may think once, you may think twice, but after some time, you are not going to bring it up over and over again to others. Which means that the more you take ownership of your action, more you will be at peace. More you actually understand that the activity, whatever that I actually do, there is karma that is in picture, there is Supreme Lord that's in picture, there is my senses, my own endeavor, everything. So when you understand about this whole gamut of things that affect the outcome of whatever action that we do, we won't feel frustrated. It's very, very easy. So for us to come in terms with reality, accept whatever that Krishna actually gives us in our life. So it's very important. This knowledge is very important.
Mm. Yes, it says the doer is a soul. And then in paragraph 40, I remember that, it actually says, well, it's the three modes of nature which are doing everything.
Good question. Who's going to answer that? So question is, who is the doer? Is it the person who is doing, or is it the modes of nature? Yes. You remember the analogy of Baladev Vidyabhushan. He gives the example of a woodcutter cutting a tree. There are three things involved here. One is the woodcutter. Second is the hand. And third is the axe. So here, if you actually see, the axe is the material nature. or technically the material modes, if you like. Okay, hand is us, which is the soul. Woodcutter is the Supreme Lord. So the way how it works is, the soul desires. This is how Krishna actually explains. The soul desires, Supreme Lord sanctions, and material nature facilitates, the modes facilitate, basically. So yes, the modes actually influence the soul, but ultimately we all have the final say in it. Just like our karma, we can't blame karma for everything. I gave this example, how karma actually can bring a tempting object right in front of us. We still have a choice. We can still transcend, taking shelter of Krishna, we can still transcend the mode. That's what we were discussing in the previous chapter also. Chanting Om Tat, chanting the holy name, taking shelter of Krishna, we can actually break ourselves free from this chain of three modes of material nature. Okay, so any activity that we actually do, yes, all three, but soul makes the choice. Once you make the choice, we are forced to live with the choice. Nature will actually force us to do. Okay, so we make the call, and then the material nature just facilitates after Supreme Lord approves.
Is that doer soul?
Which one? The doer is soul, yes. Yes.
So just testing my understanding. So karma is required, like karma is there for accomplishment of action or result of action?
Karma is there to create a situation.
So here, where does karma fit in? So due to karma, we get a particular body and senses?
Endeavor. So our action, that's where we actually like create the karma.
One is supreme and one is your endeavor. That's all is needed.
That endeavor, which you actually say, that it's just used in a different context actually. What we call endeavor there, that's what we call action here. So this action means, or activity. I just use the same terminology as Prabhupada uses. Okay, any activity that you do, it's actually influenced by these five. And in the next verse, immediately Krishna also says, in 19th verse, if you actually see, Krishna says there are three things that gives inspiration, motivation. And there are three things that are actually every action is constituted by. Okay, if you want to go really technical there. But idea is, we are not the only controller. Just like Prabhupada says, even in this body, we are not the only resident of this body. We may think we are, but you know, there may be so many worms living in the body. And they may be thinking, with their false ego, I have such a big body, who is this guy moving? So, Prabhupada is saying, we may move, but they actually live there in the body, okay? But there's always a battle of ego between us, okay?
But if you see verse 327, you say that the spirit soul bewildered by the influence of false ego thinks itself to be different.
Yeah. The material modes makes one actually think that he is doing the activity. That's why Krishna is giving the knowledge here. Actually, it's not the... Even if you do some activity here, some action, let us say the material mode actually creates a situation outside of Krishna consciousness, the person will be almost 100% influenced by the modes, actually. And he will be thinking in that mode, he will be thinking, I am the one who is doing the activity. So Krishna is dissecting here and saying, by the way, you are thinking... due to the influence of this mode that you are the doer, but actually any activity that you do inside the mode, these five things are involved. But when you take up to Krishna consciousness, with this knowledge you actually understand, I'm just a tiny, tiny person here who's just making the choice. And then there's modes of material nature which is facilitated and Krishna gives the sanction. So this knowledge is available only for devotees. Prabhupada clearly says that in the purports, that somebody who doesn't turn towards the scriptures, this wisdom will actually evade them. However, one who is in Krishna consciousness, to accept this, first you have to accept Krishna here, correct? Mayavadis can't accept this. Because for them, there is no supreme per se. So that's what Prabhupada actually says, that to accept this knowledge, one should come in contact with the bona fide spiritual master, Prabhupada says, or one should come in contact with Krishna directly. One or the other should be true. I think we should move on before we go back to the questions. The chapter is long. We'll finish the chapter before we come. Please keep your questions there. We'll come back. Okay, so this is one section which Krishna gives here. Now, if you look at the next section, as I said, the next section is just an expansion of this one. So if you go to the next one, which is 19 to 40. So there if you see one's work according to the five factors, if you look at your summary. Verse 18, 19 to 40, it's under karma. One's work according to the five factors mentioned above. here is dictated by the three modes of nature. This includes one's knowledge, one's actions, one's performance of action, one's understanding, one's determination, and one's happiness. Now, what Krishna is doing here is, he is then extending it. For example, if you take one's performance of action, understanding, determination, and happiness. Now, senses, subtle senses also include, there are different faculties for the mind. You know, memory is one faculty, for example. Likewise, Krishna is saying, intelligence is one. Determination is again another attribute. That you have happiness, again emotions, that's also another attribute. Emotions is faculty of mind. Wisdom is faculty of intelligence. Memory, faculty of intelligence. So if you look at this, so Krishna is saying, he's just going, dissecting even further and saying, senses, which actually includes both intelligence, determination and happiness, which is here if you see verses 29 to 32, 33 to 35, and 36 to 39. Each one of them, they in turn can be under modes. You know, they can be in mode of goodness, passion, ignorance. So same way, determination also can be of three types. Happiness also can be of three types. So same way, Krishna says, doer, karta, he can also be of three types. Jnana, knowledge, again, technically comes under the faculty of intelligence only. That also can be of three types. Performance of action, activity, endeavor, that's also three types. So the next section, 19 to 40, first Krishna establishes that there are five aspects, and then Krishna goes more detail. There are, under senses, there are each of these. There is knowledge, there is intelligence, there is determination, happiness, and there is the type of activity that you actually do. Each one of them, depending on the mode that is actually influencing you, the outcome will be different, your behavior will be different, so on and so forth. That's what Krishna is saying here. For example, in happiness under the mode of goodness, Prabhupada says that it will taste like poison in the beginning, and as you keep practicing it, it will become like a nectar at the end, waking up early in the morning, for example. We hate waking up early in the morning, but as you keep doing it, once you get habituated to that, you will then be able to accept the benefit that comes with that. Okay, and then happiness in the mode of goodness. Prabhupada says if a boy and a girl comes and just keep passion alone as their bond between the bond in the relationship, basically, then he says initially it will be good. It will taste like nectar in the beginning and it will end up as poison, Prabhupada says. Whereas happiness in the mode of ignorance, that is something like, you know, it's starting to end, it's always painful only, like anger. As time goes, it gets even more worse, basically. So likewise, each one of them, if you actually study, you will see each one of them. Same way, determination, Krishna actually explains, that determination which is unshakable, irrespective of any reversal that you actually have, that determination is in mode of goodness. And whereas that determination which is shaky, it goes like sinusoidal goes, with ups and downs, he says that's in mode of passion. Whereas that determination which is not at all aroused in the body, which is not at all aroused in one's intelligence, Prabhupada says no enthusiasm at all, that's in determination and mode of ignorance, like that. So same way, intelligence, understanding, same way Krishna gives about jnana, and same way about the activity itself. So this is the next section. So next section, 19 to 40, is just an expansion of this idea. The concept here Krishna is teaching is, every action that we do, it has got five different aspects, five different factors that influence them. And then if you analyze each one of them in turn is actually controlled by modes. So Krishna, after presenting all this, so in this whole jigsaw puzzle, you are just one single piece. Where is the doer? Here.
So if they are controlled by
modes,
then what relationship has a soul? The soul is so blinded.
Correct. That is why knowledge is so important. So the whole idea of karma, this is what, remember, Krishna actually says, Kim karma kim akarmeti kavayopi atra mohitaha. That's why understanding karma is super complicated. Krishna tells to Arjuna, forget it. Krishna, after giving all this knowledge, wait until we come to 1866. Krishna will say, forget everything, just surrender to me. That's the easiest thing to do. It is complicated, definitely. So that's the whole idea. The whole idea of us studying all this is to forget. Like, seriously, forget about all this and just go. Because but that's Brahma's conclusion also. After sitting in meditation for 100 celestial years to understand Krishna, he says, I come to this conclusion. What's my conclusion? After doing tapasya, austerity for 100 years, my conclusion is, even after you do tapasya for 100 years, you cannot understand Krishna. That's my conclusion. So same way, even after understanding, how much can we control? It's very hard. We'll get overly paranoid when we go with this. But Krishna is saying, so you understand this is knowledge, basically. And whoever understands scriptures, whoever has faith in the scriptures, this knowledge is accessible. Being aware of the scheme of things that's actually happening around, Krishna says, stay cool, just chant Hare Krishna, follow four regulative principles, and go back to Godhead. Easy. Okay? Bhakti Yoga is the easiest. Jnana Yoga is the complicated one. Okay, so that's the idea. So this is how the next section 19 to 40, that's laid out. Okay? We'll go to the following section. From Sakama to Nishkama Karma Yoga. Now, we studied earlier in Bhagavad Gita that one's varna is determined based on guna and karma, whatever quality and whatever activity that the person does. So this section, 41 to 48, if you see, it actually teaches on, if you go to the verses, very merciful section, not many purport, long purports there. So if you go to verse 41, Krishna says, Brahmana, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras are distinguished by the qualities born of their own natures in accordance with the material modes, O chastiser of enemy. And then Krishna goes to explain about different qualities. Somebody who is a Brahmana, what qualities he has. Somebody who is a Kshatriya in 43. Somebody who is Vaishya and Shudra, that's in 44. So the idea here is that Krishna is saying all of us are born with a certain quality, certain nature, and that nature was determined based on our karma from previous life. We acquire those qualities. So Krishna is saying, if you are a Brahmana, you stick to your Brahminical duty and you simply keep on doing. Prabhupada says truthfulness, that's one quality. There was one kid, Prabhupada quotes this story. There was one kid who goes to a guru, Gautama Rishi, and he says, oh Gurudev, please accept me as your student. And Gautama says, all right, what's your father's name? And the kid says, I don't know. I'll ask my mom and come. So he goes to the mother and he asks the mother. And the mother says, like, look, my dear child, when I was young, I was a bit loose in my character. I don't know who your father is. Then the little kid goes to Gautama Rishi and then tells, come, sorry, Gurudev, my mother doesn't know who she begot me through. Then Gautama says, then you are a Brahmana. Because the child went to the parent, the mother didn't know, comes back to the guru and being truthful. Usually if somebody is in that position, what would they do? They'll say someone else basically, right? Just to protect their candidature under the guru. So Gautama says, this is, you are a Brahmana because you are truthful, and he accepts him. So Prabhupada quoting this says that our nature, our qualities, everything we are born with. Like for a little kid, nobody taught him. He's yet to go to Gurukul. Nobody actually taught him that you are supposed to be truthful, but the quality actually comes out. Whereas something like, if you see for Kshatriyas, heroism, power, determination, resourcefulness. If you read Ramayana, this is one quality which even Lord Ram actually demonstrates. When Vibhishan is brother of Ravan. So Vibhishan, he abandons Ravan's camp because he knows he's the bad guy. He comes to take shelter of the Supreme Lord Ram. As soon as Vibhishan comes to Lord Ram, because Kshatriyas, they always boast their strength. They always are very confident of their power. So Lord Ram, of course, he is Supreme Lord. He exhibits his quality, even as this is one of the qualities of the Supreme Lord also. He exhibits confidence so much so that here is Vibhishan. He is just one person from the entire army of Rakshasas. War hasn't started yet. But Lord Ram was so confident of his victory, he first of all calls him Lankapati, that you are the future king of Lanka. That's one thing. Second is, he immediately coronates him also. He takes him to the beach, takes the water, pours on his hand, and he says, from today I actually coronate you as the king of the Rakshasas, king of Lanka, even before even one arrow was actually shot. So that's a Kshatriya spirit basically. But Kshatriya spirit is one, but here we are talking about the transcendental quality. But many places you will see even Lord Ram actually demonstrated. He demonstrates a transcendental anger also when he goes in front of the ocean god, waiting for the ocean god to come to give him an audience. Ocean god doesn't respond. Lord Ram gets very angry. It's mentioned that his eyes became like copper red. So each of these qualities that's actually mentioned in these verses, in Kali Yuga especially, because we don't follow Varnashrama Dharma, we have a bit of everything. Okay. But chanting Hare Krishna, Prabhupada said, simply by chanting Hare Krishna, Anybody can be elevated to the level of Vaishnavas, and being a Vaishnava is greater than even Brahmana. There is one famous pastime there with the Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, who is the spiritual master of our Srila Prabhupada. So this happened during Bhakti Vinod Thakur's time. So Bhakti, there was one big assembly of Vaishnavas and Brahmanas, and there was a debate that was going on for days. And they asked Bhakti Vinod Thakur to come there and speak on behalf of Vaishnavas. The whole topic of debate is, who is superior, Vaishnavas or Brahmanas? So then, the day when Bhakti Vinod Thakur was supposed to actually go, that was the final day, he gets afflicted with sickness, so he stays home, and he sends his son instead, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So Bhakti Siddhanta goes there. Initially, first thing Bhakti Siddhanta does is, he glorifies Brahmanas. Brahmanas are so great. Brahmanas are so greater than even demigods. Even demigods come and touch the feet of Brahmanas. He gives example of also Vashishta Muni, Vishwamitra Muni. They are so powerful and everything. So Brahmanas feel happy. They also think, is he siding with us? But then after he finishes glorifying Brahmanas, he then goes on to glorify Vaishnavas, saying how Vaishnavas are even greater. He says, only those who are Brahman realized they are Brahmanas, but those who are Bhagavan realized they are Vaishnavas. So Bhagavan aspect is obviously the most perfect, complete aspect of the Supreme Lord. So he establishes the supremacy of Vaishnavas. And at the end, it's actually given, everyone comes and falls at his feet, taking his shelter, even the Brahmanas actually. So each one of these qualities, Prabhupada says, by training, it is possible. Because chanting Hare Krishna is so powerful. That's why in our process, we don't focus so much on austerity, actually speaking. We don't focus so much on difficulty that one has to actually go through. Like in some sampradaya, here we are, like, you know, brahmacharis, we can either shave the head using a shaving razor, or you can use a clipper, basically, like, you know, like a buzzer, we can use that. But in some sampradayas, before they actually take diksha, even as a brahmachari or sannyasi, they will literally pluck each hair. The idea is to shave the head. Why don't you keep shaving every fortnight? You know, they do that. Extreme austerity. So in one place, actually, Prabhupada says, that's austerity in mode of ignorance. You wanted an example of that, that's an example. All you want to do is shave it, what do you have to pluck it out? They do that. So like that, you go to extremes, actually. It's not authorized in scriptures, but they do. But the idea here is that everyone is born with each of these qualities. Simply by taking shelter of Krishna's service, this section is actually talking about Shakama Karma Yoga, wherein you still understand what your quality is, what your characteristic is, what nature you have actually acquired in birth, what your psychophysical nature is, and you engage in Krishna's service, you engage in your occupational duty, rather. That way, and then slowly you'll be able to elevate. If we engage in, even in Krishna consciousness also, if we do service which suits our psychophysical nature, controlling mind becomes very easy. Otherwise, doing activity, doing a particular thing itself is austere. If that activity is something you hate, it becomes double austere. So might as well pick up something which you are very passionate about. Passionate not in terms of rajas, passionate in terms of something which you connect to more. And then take up that service. It can be cooking, cleaning, singing, speaking, anything. And then do it that way. That way it becomes natural. We get properly engaged according to our nature. So we benefit both the ways. We feel satisfied of having achieved something. But at the same time, we'll also make spiritual progress. So that's the idea. So this section talks about Sakama Karma Yoga. Now, next is section 49 to 55. It speaks about how from Sakama Karma Yoga, you actually go to the transcendental platform. This is again just a summary of what we discussed before. So you engage in Sakama Karma Yoga. Then that will actually lead to knowledge. With that knowledge, we'll slowly start to get liberated, and that liberation one becomes Brahman realized. That is liberation. And then from there, Mam Chayo Avyabhicharena Bhakti Yogaina Sevate Sagunan Samati Tetan Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate. So once someone comes to the level of Brahman, then there is no more material pangs, so he engages in devotional service. And from there, goes back to Godhead. So that's the flow of this section. So you engage in Sakama Karma Yoga, you, based on your psychophysical nature, engage in an activity, and then slowly, Krishna actually says, every activity, if we engage it in a proper Karma Yoga properly, then we get knowledge as a result, and that knowledge will slowly lead one towards detachment. Like we saw these different five factors of knowledge and everything. When we understand we don't really fully control, slowly we'll come to the platform of getting detached, and then one becomes Brahman realized, then gets a devotional service and one goes back to Godhead. Now we may think, in Krishna consciousness, we never know we did Karma Yoga, we don't know about knowledge, we don't know whether we were Brahman realized, but we are doing devotional service directly. That's why Prabhupada says, being a devotee means you are a millionaire, billionaire. You are automatically a millionaire, Prabhupada says. So if, let us say, Brahman realized is millionaire, because this is the advanced stage, right? So once they ask this question to Prabhupada, we never remember any time in the past of us doing any of these activity. All we remember is all sinful activities we did, but how come we are now able to do devotional service? Prabhupada said, I gave you all the punya, you don't worry about it. So if somebody comes directly to the platform of devotional service, Prabhupada says he is a billionaire, which means he has $1 billion. Prabhupada says, naturally he'll have $1 million. Naturally he'll have $1,000. Naturally he'll have 100. So that's why devotional service, bhakti yoga process is like Prabhupada says, it's getting on an elevator. You go straight to the topmost platform straight away. You don't need to climb the stair. You don't need to go to each floor and anything. So this is the crux of the next section, which is confidential knowledge, verse 49 to 55. And each of these Krishna explained in detail in the early chapters, especially the first six we saw. All right, so next section, working in pure devotional service. This is verse 56 to 60. So let's quickly read this section. Though engaged in all kinds of activities, my pure devotee under my protection reaches the eternal and imperishable abode by my grace. In all activities, just depend on me and work under my protection. In such devotional service, be fully conscious of me. Krishna is assuring. Prabhupada is actually writing in the purport, we don't need to be afraid of whatever past karma we did, whatever bad activities we did, either in this life or in the past life, or something which we are even doing, forced to do even now, helplessly. Prabhupada says occasional lapse is always come forgiven by Krishna. But Prabhupada says, but if we think we'll keep on doing sinful activity on the strength of devotional service, Prabhupada says Krishna doesn't like the plan. In one conversation, Prabhupada says. So our mood should always be, we should try our best to give up sinful activity and take shelter of Krishna. Occasionally there may be lapse, but Prabhupada says still one should determinedly come back to the lotus feet of Krishna, and we should never let go of chanting. As long as we keep doing it, then there is no fall down. Fall down means refusing to get up. That's Prabhupada's definition. Like, you know, a little kid, God knows, you know, how many zillion times it falls before it starts to walk. But if first time it falls, he says like, nah, I can't do it, then it will never be able to walk. So same way, even in our devotional service, even in our bhakti, many times we may fumble, we may actually slip, we may fall. But as soon as we actually keep getting up and we walk, we don't need to worry. In one instance, one disciple is actually telling to Prabhupada, if I get into bad association, I'll fall down. Prabhupada is saying, you're already fallen down. What's the chance to fall down even more? So our focus should always be to aim to please the Supreme Lord, Sri Sri Radha Gopinath. And then Krishna is repeatedly saying, he offers my protection. We read that in 56, we read that in 57. Krishna will again reiterate it later also. 58, if one becomes conscious of me, you will pass over all the obstacles of conditioned life by my grace. If, however, you do not work in such consciousness but act through false ego, not hearing me, you will lost. This is very important because usually if you face any reversals in life, we tend to get some encouragement from our friends, could be from our parents, could be relatives, anybody. So you'll get some sort of an encouragement. But that encouragement would be more shallow. It won't be as deep as the kind of encouragement which Arjuna is getting from Krishna. Correct? Arjuna is saying, I won't fight. Krishna doesn't tell Arjuna, you know, chill out, bro, take a break, you can go back, fight. He's not giving such a shallow advice. He's walking him through, fully enlightening him. One without the other will be very shallow. If someone gives just encouragement, it'll be very, very shallow. There won't be any philosophical basis for it. It won't be spiritual, per se. If someone just speaks on enlightenment, it will look like a sermon without any encouragement at all, actually. If you read Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita does both. You will find in many places, especially from chapter 2 to all the way to 17, Krishna gave whole gamut of topics actually in between, explaining each concept, how karma works, how you are the doer, how material nature works, so on and so forth. He enlightened Arjuna in this philosophy of Krishna consciousness. And then now he is going for encouragement. In between also Krishna says, my devotees are very near, Shipram Bhavati Dharmatma, even if somebody falls down, you should consider him as saintly. So you see, occasionally Krishna is also giving encouragement. 18th chapter especially, we'll see in the final section, 64 to 66, where Krishna's encouragement will hit its peak. Krishna will say, forget everything. Just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all reactions. Do not fear. That's Krishna's final statement to his devotees. And Krishna repeatedly, you will see, he encourages. Bhagavad Gita offers these two. Scriptures offers these two. And Bhakti Yoga process, it offers these two. It doesn't just give some lofty ideas and say like, all right, now do the best you can. It doesn't say that. It tells clearly what the problem is. And then it encourages us to follow that. And it also tells us there will be difficulty, doesn't matter. Bhagavad Gita is a very, very practical science. Okay, so Bhakti Yoga process alone offers these two. When sometime, you know, even among devotees, sometime we may be approached by some devotees for advice, anything. In which case, both are required. We can't just give a philosophical answer. Like, for example, even Apichetsu Duracharo, even if somebody does the most abominable activity, he should be considered as saintly. That instruction is for us when it comes to dealing with others. We should not use that for ourselves. Okay, we should not do a sinful activity and say, I'm still a saint. That's not the idea here. Idea here is that verse is supposed to, when you deal with the other person, you see somebody else struggling in Krishna consciousness, you use that verse there. So the standard is always, like for Radhanath Maharaj, devotees actually say, for him, he'll be very, very strict, but for others, he'll be very, very lenient. That's ideal standard. For ourselves, we should actually follow without giving ourselves any excuse. We should try. That doesn't mean we should feel completely bogged down. Oh, I'm a loser. Not in that sense. We should confidently try. We should not relax. We should be sincere and strict. But when it comes to dealing with other people, other you know, fellow students or like, you know, fellow mates, anybody who comes to us for guidance, we should be as lenient as possible. We should always look at positive things. There, Apichetsu Duracharo verse kicks in. You should consider them saintly. Usually, we tend to do the other way around. Remember the glass object example? When we do, first thing you do is like, you know, you wind up, throw it. But for us, we should be strict. Strict not in terms of fanatically strict. Strict in terms of be sincere. But for others, we should be always be encouraging as much as possible. But we should simultaneously give both. Enlightenment in terms of spiritual knowledge. Encouragement in terms of, you know, practical down-to-earth solutions. Both are required. Then such an advice is complete. That's in accordance with Bhagavad Gita. Okay, let's move to the next section. Next section is about 61 to 63. Krishna speaks about surrendering to the super soul. Now, super soul, we discussed about super soul so many places. This is verse 61 to 63. Surrender to super soul. This is more confidential knowledge. So here, this is one often quote verse of Prabhupada. Prabhupada says that the super soul is actually present in our body, in the region of our heart, always directing the living entities all the time. So the super soul is there only in the material world, accompanying the jiva. No matter in what species the jiva takes birth in, super soul always follows. And then until it goes, the jiva goes back to the spiritual world, super soul always follows there. Now, many times, I think I mentioned this before. Sometimes when Krishna actually says in Bhagavad Gita, you know, Krishna will give knowledge from inside. How do we know that the knowledge which we are actually hearing, all of us hear voices, okay, many times. But the problem is we don't know whether it's our mind's voice or super soul's voice. Most of the time we hear our mind's voice, which will tell us the most easiest thing to do. It will always tell everyone else is wrong and you are right. And it will always tell us that you are right. You can just go on with whatever you are doing. How do we know what is Krishna's voice and what is our voice? Prabhupada is actually saying in one lecture in Vrindavan that Paramatma, he doesn't speak to anyone and everyone. Okay, so Prabhupada actually says there, only those who are fully devoted to constantly doing. Tesham satateyuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam. Prabhupada quotes that verse. Only those who are devoted to constantly doing devotional service, Krishna says, to them I give intelligence. So Prabhupada is saying, not to any other person, any random person, Krishna doesn't speak. So we have to understand, how do we understand whether Krishna is actually saying or our mind is saying, that only we know. How active are we in engaging in Krishna consciousness? How active are we in practicing bhakti? How sincere are we in practicing bhakti? Are we looking for opportunity to space out, or are we looking for opportunity to expand our service? Okay, are we trying to attentively, at least attempt to attentively chant, or are we going through Facebook as we chant? So each of those, we need to be sincere with ourselves. That will determine how much guidance we can get from inside. If we don't, Vaishnavas are more merciful just to talk to devotees and get advice. But from inside means, Prabhupada says, that's the criteria. Otherwise, many times we'll get confused. And many times you see people in the street. Once Prabhupada is going for a fundraising, and he goes, please give money. And then the person who is very wealthy, he's saying that, oh Swamiji, whenever Krishna wishes, I will give. Basically, that's his way of saying no. Prabhupada says that Krishna wishes, that's why he sent me. Then the person gives him the check. Who can argue with Prabhupada? So, point is that, but many times we try to use philosophy also for our sense gratification. We have to be very, very careful that scriptures are there clearly and guidance is there outside. We should always correct ourselves. We should always consult Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. Okay, GSS. Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. And all of them should align. Ultimate authority is always Shastra, scriptures. Okay, so that's why studying scriptures is so important. So in 61 to 63, Prabhupada speaks about surrendering to the Super Soul. 64 to 66, most confidential knowledge. So we are coming to the concluding verses of Bhagavad Gita. 64 to 66. Most confidential. Reason why Krishna is giving this as most confidential is, we discussed this before, because this knowledge is so powerful, this process is so powerful, that anyone who takes shelter of Krishna, Krishna becomes completely indebted to them. Like, we know the story, one of, there are many qualities, we'll be discussing that in Nectar of Devotion, 64 qualities of Krishna. One quality of Krishna is he's extremely grateful. We know the story of Sudama Vipra Brahmana. He just gave Krishna a handful of rice. And for that, Rukmini Devi already reciprocated with so much wealth. Krishna is still thinking, how much he gave and how little am I actually giving? In another place, when Krishna is actually speaking to the gopis, look at Krishna's way of looking at things. He's saying that all of you are fully surrendered, given up your parents, given up your husbands, kids, everything, and you have surrendered to me. Which means Krishna's logic is, Krishna is here, all the gopis are here. Krishna is saying, you have given up everything, and for all of you, I'm the only object of love. But Krishna is saying, materialistically speaking, Krishna is feeling humble, and he's saying, but look at me, I'm so tiny, my love is actually divided among you. I can never be able to reciprocate exclusive devotion to each one of you. But that's not true. We also study that, you know, Om Purnamada Purnamidam. It's not. But Krishna is feeling like that. If you read that section, Krishna is saying, Krishna's glory, Krishna won't say it out until, like, you know, someone like Arjuna asks him a question. Please tell me your glory. Again and again, please tell me your glory, like that. So Krishna is very, very grateful. So when somebody knows this knowledge about Krishna, they can go exploit Krishna also. Prabhupada says there was one thief who was once sitting and listening a Bhagavatam class, and there he hears, if you go to Vrindavan, you can see Krishna, and he wears all costly jewels. So thief, obviously, what will he think? If I go there, this guy looks innocent, so I can take the jewel. So that day, Mother Yashoda dressed Krishna, baby Krishna, in a certain way with all the jewelry. And Krishna is going to the forest to herd all the calves. He's still a Gopal only, young boy. So he goes there. This thief finally searches in Vrindavan, goes to every forest, and finally he catches Krishna. And he says, okay, come, Prabhupada is narrating this story in one lecture in a very, very touching way. Nobody can do justice on Prabhupada. Like, you know, does Prabhupada chokes up also many places? So he comes to Krishna and he says, oh, you are a very sweet looking boy. And Krishna is feeling very shy. Krishna, when he acts, he'll act exactly like a 5-year-old boy. So he goes there and he's like, no, I have nothing. I'm just a cowherd boy. And then this person says like, no, you take this. I'll give you some sweets here. Please take this. Give me all these jewels. They are too heavy for you and everything. So then Krishna allows him to take every jewel. So at one point, Krishna has got no jewel except the dhoti. But this person, after taking, just by coming in contact with Krishna, after he takes everything, he looks at Krishna and he feels spontaneously, because Krishna smiles, obviously. So when Krishna smiles, he gets like, you know, bewildered. And when he looks at Krishna, he sees like, oh, what a sweet boy. I like to do service. Then he ends up decorating him with the same jewels again. Evening, he goes to Mother Yashoda. Mother Yashoda chastises Krishna. Why are you actually changing the jewels in different place? Morning, I put in different place. Why have you changed? That is beauty of Krishna. When somebody goes to Krishna, Krishna actually give himself to him. Prabhupada says, why are you fighting to get this wealth, that wealth? Prabhupada says, Mayavadis, Prabhupada uses the word rascals, you know, so they want to become one with God. You can become greater than God. Look at Mother Yashoda. She is greater than God. You should be aiming to become greater than God, Prabhupada is saying. So this same opportunity that was available for Mother Yashoda, one place Prabhupada is saying, we should never think, oh, Arjuna was with Krishna. Arjuna know who Krishna is. So serving Krishna was very easy. What's so big about it? But Prabhupada is saying, the same opportunity that was available for Subhadra Maharani, same opportunity that was available for Arjuna, same opportunity that was available for all the Gopas and Gopis, Prabhupada is saying, that same exact opportunity is available for all of us. This is Krishna. He's standing here. And Prabhupada is actually pointing at the deities and he's saying, we can actually have exactly same opportunity. We can reciprocate. We can serve Krishna in the exact intimate way with the deities. He is available. That same opportunity is available for all of us. And Prabhupada is saying we should never give that as an excuse not to do. And then each one of us should actually be aspiring to actually do service, menial service. In deity service, Archan, when we actually do, there is one verse we recite that the spiritual master is assisting Srimati Radharani as a gopi, as a manjari, and we are assisting the spiritual master. So simply by following the footsteps of the spiritual master, one day Prabhupada says, slowly but surely, we'll come face to face with God and we'll be able to serve him. So that's why this knowledge is very, very confidential. One day Ashwatthama is Drona's son, he goes to Krishna and he says, Krishna, can I have your Sudarshana Chakra? And then Krishna says, yeah, you can take. And then Krishna says, here it is, take. Sudarshana Chakra is very, very heavy. It said its weight is all the universe's weight put together. That's how heavy it is. Only Krishna can wield it. So he tries to lift. Ashwatthama goes to Krishna and he says, can I just borrow it for a day? Krishna says, yeah, take it, no problem. I'm not using it. So he tries to lift. It doesn't. Finally, he gives up and he says, it's too heavy for me. As he was walking out, Krishna actually asked him, by the way, why do you want to take this chakra? And then Ashwatthama tells to Krishna, oh, don't you know, if I have this chakra, I can go challenge every king. I can conquer the whole world. I can kill even you. Krishna looks at him, smiles, and he says, yeah, that's a good idea. I like that. And then he just walks away, very dejected. But all of that, if you see Ambarish Maharaj, when Durvasa Muni coming and hurling this big demon towards him, he didn't call for, but Sudarshana Chakra comes for his protection, as if Sudarshana is at the disposal of a pure devotee. Prabhupada is writing in second canto, we were discussing this on Bhagavatam class, Bhakti Yoga is so powerful, and Prabhupada is giving example. There are devotees who practiced Bhakti starting from the womb. And Prabhupada is giving example, Parishit Maharaj, Sukadeva Goswami. There are bhaktas who started when they are 5 years old. Prabhupada is giving example of Dhruva Maharaj. Those who started practicing Bhakti Yoga at the prime of their youth, Ambarish Maharaj. And Prabhupada is extending that saying, there are people who picked up in the later age, Dhritarashtra, Prabhupada is saying, out of frustration of his plan backfiring, he goes and takes up transcendental bath. And Prabhupada is saying, there are people who took Bhakti at the time of death, Ajamil. And Prabhupada is saying there are people who did bhakti even in heaven and hell. He's quoting Chitragita Maharaj actually. So Prabhupada is saying bhakti yoga is something where a baby from the womb all the way from womb to tomb, you can practice bhakti yoga. You can start anytime. You can, it's never too late. We can try, we can choose our own pace, we can choose our own way of doing, we can choose our own level. Krishna consciousness is all encompassing. Nobody is too sinful to not be able to do bhakti yoga. That's how powerful it is. Confidential knowledge. That's why Krishna, he reserves this knowledge to give only those who take shelter of spiritual master. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Okay, so 64, because you are my dear friend, Krishna said the same thing, fourth chapter. I'm speaking to you, my supreme instruction, the most confidential knowledge of all. Hear this from me, for this is for your benefit. You know, when you say something very confidential, you'll go close to the ears. And he says like, hey, listen. That's what Krishna is saying here. There's a lot of emotions involved. 65, so Prabhupada says, if one does these four things, Prabhupada says, one can go back to spiritual world. There's no doubt about it. Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me and offer your homage to me. This is the last verse in 9th chapter, 934, I believe. So, this is the same verse. Krishna said there also, 9th chapter, 18th chapter also, he's repeating. Always think of me, become my devotee, worship me and offer your homage to me. So, four things. Become my devotee, that's one. Worship me. Second is worshipping. Third is offer your homage to me. Think of me. Always think of me. Manmana bhava madbhakto. Always think of me. Become my devotee. Worship me and offer your homage to me. Homage to me means offer prayers, bow down to Krishna. Thus you will come to me without fail. And Krishna is saying, I promise you. Satya Sankalpa. One of Krishna's potency is whatever he says becomes true. Okay, Satya Sankalpa. I promise you this because you are my very dear friend. Krishna is saying, because you are non-envious of me, you are coming to my shelter, I promise this to you. Next verse, 1866, it's very important. Definitely everyone should memorize this verse. Anta, usually when we study Veda, Veda means knowledge. Veda means knowledge. Vedanta. Anta means conclusion. Conclusion of knowledge. Vedanta means actually anta, and that is conclusion. Now same way for Bhagavad Gita, the anta, the conclusion of entire Bhagavad Gita is 1866. Okay. We can recite this verse together. Or maybe you can follow me. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami masuchaha. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. Krishna is giving encouragement here. So this is the ultimate promise of Krishna to his devotee, to his surrendered devotee. Krishna is saying, you have heard about all these different processes of yoga, and Krishna gave a whole range of things, gamut of things in this chapter also. You see, and Krishna is saying, finally, just abandon everything. Whatever you heard, forget about everything, just surrender to me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reactions. Do not fear. So that's what Krishna is saying here. So this is the conclusion. 67 to 71. It speaks about teaching, studying Bhagavad Gita and preaching to others. This confidential knowledge may never be explained to those who are not austere or devoted or engaged in devotional service, nor to one who is envious of me. 68 and 69, very important. For one who explains the supreme secret to the devotees, pure devotional service is guaranteed, and at the end, he will come back to me. That's my only hope for starting scripture study course. So, you also please teach to other people. That's the idea. We can distribute books, we can preach, you can even teach your friends, even one person. You can share it with your partner, with your family members, anybody. Okay, so now listen to 69, very important. And there is no servant in this world more dear to me than he, nor will there be one more dear. Now Krishna can just stop with, there is no servant in this world more dear to me than he. Because whatever Krishna says is absolute. But then somebody may say, what if somebody comes and supersedes that position? Krishna is, that's why adding future also here. Nor in future, which means one who shares this knowledge with others, Krishna is saying he is the topmost servant. Anybody can become. Srimati Radharani, she is very expert in sharing Krishna with others. That's why she is standing. She is very, very dear to Krishna. She is very, very merciful. Even Tulsi Maharani, Devamrita Maharaj is giving in one lecture. We usually say, Vrindaya Tulsi Devyaya, Priyaya Keshavasya. We say, Priyaya Keshavasya. Oh, Tulsi, beloved of Krishna, we recite. And he is explaining the reason why Vrinda Devi is so dear to Krishna is because she is very expert in taking all the fallen conditioned souls back to Krishna, even unqualified people also. If you read, there is a book by Bhakti Sharma Madhav Maharaj, Tulsi Amrita. We have some copies. If you read that, you will see there are so many different stories also that's given, so many pastimes. Even if somebody is haunted by ghost, Tulsi Maharani, if you come under her shade, the ghost will actually run away. So many benefits that's given. In Purana also there is one story that's actually given. One day what happens, I try to narrate this story, always I get choked up. I'll try. So one day one Brahmana, what he does is like he goes to cut some grass. Accidentally he plucks a tulsi plant and he comes holding it. As he was holding it, his karma is actually saying he is supposed to be bitten by a snake and he should die. So what happens? The Brahmana carries the grass along with Tulsi Maharani accidentally and he goes. Snake goes behind the Brahmana and the snake actually thinks, let this guy drop the Tulsi and then I'll actually bite. So the snake, I'm already feeling. Okay, so the snake actually... So the snake goes, then Vishnu is actually thinking in Goloka Vrindavan because he has actually made this promise, whoever worships Tulsi Maharani, he will actually come under protection of Vishnu. So then what Vishnu thinks is, okay, maybe I should send Sudarshan Chakra. But then he looks for Sudarshan Chakra, it's already gone. So there is this grass that the Brahmana is going, snake is going behind him, Sudarshan Chakra goes behind him. And behind him, even Vishnu goes. Slowly, 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 slowly. And then finally, when that person actually reaches there, Sudarshan Chakra comes, chops off the snake, and that person actually goes back to the spiritual world. That's how merciful Tulsi Maharani is. So this, but Krishna here, he is saying, one who is preaching this message, nobody is more dear to me than he. That's the position which Krishna is giving for us. So we are indebted. We pass this knowledge. We get this knowledge from Srila Prabhupada. We should pass it on to other people. That's the responsibility we all have. Okay, 70. And I declare that he who studies this sacred conversation of ours worships me by his intelligence. So even studying the scripture, even hearing the lectures, even attending the class, we are worshipping Krishna with our intelligence. So this is one way of worshipping. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, each one of those processes. And 71, and one who listens with faith and without envy becomes free from sinful reactions and attains to the auspicious planets where the pious dwell. So that's the power of studying Bhagavad Gita. 72 to 73. This verse 72 is very important because Krishna is, after speaking all this, he is telling to Arjuna, O son of Pritha, O conqueror of wealth, have you heard this with an attentive mind? And are your ignorance and illusions now dispelled? Now Krishna is, after speaking 700 verses, he is actually telling to Arjuna. What is he telling to Arjuna? Are you satisfied with the answer? And Prabhupada is writing in the purport, as a dutiful teacher, if Arjuna had said, no, it's still not clear, Krishna was prepared. Prabhupada is actually writing, Krishna was prepared to speak the entire Gita again. Okay? If Krishna is ready to speak the entire Gita again, if Arjuna hadn't actually understood it, so we should take the same approach. If we don't understand, what should we do? Read the Gita again. You read it once, read it twice, you will get acquainted. Over a period of time, you will remember Gita as a story. And time and again, you will see Bhagavatam is just expansion of Bhagavad Gita. Chaitanya Charitamrita, expansion of Bhagavad Gita. You can link each and every verse of the scripture back to Gita, Bhakti Shastras. So it's very, very important, actually. 73. 73 is one powerful argument against Mayavad. So this verse 73 is one powerful argument against Mayavad. Because in 73, Arjuna is now saying, Arjuna said, "My dear Krishna, O infallible one, my illusion is now gone." Okay, listen carefully. His illusion is gone. "I have regained my memory by your mercy," but he is still accepting Krishna's position as the Supreme Lord. Now, Mayavadis say, we are one single blob as Brahman. Because we came in the spell of illusion, we are now embodied now. Once the illusion is gone, we'll go back and we'll reclaim our godship. But this verse, Arjuna is clearly saying that, "O infallible one, my illusion is now gone. I have regained my memory by your mercy. I am now firm and free from doubt and prepared to act according to your instructions." So Prabhupada is saying, even in liberated condition, because his illusion is gone now, he himself is saying, even in liberated condition, what is he saying? "I am your servant. Karisya vachanam tava. I'll simply follow whatever you are asking me to do." So Prabhupada is saying, this verse directly challenges Mayavadi's notion. And what is their notion? Only in illusory state we have to be serving Krishna. Once we become liberated, we can be happy. We are God ourselves. But Prabhupada is saying, no, Arjuna in liberated state, he is saying, I'm prepared to follow your instructions. Okay, so this is 72 and 73. Arjuna is now free of his illusion. 74 to 78. So this section actually speaks on Sanjaya's predictions. He's predicting in the future. Sanjaya is saying repeatedly, just hearing this, my hair is standing on end. Sometimes we feel repeatedly hearing, we go to sleep. Where is he and where is our emotion? I mean, what is this emotion we actually go through? But this is what we go through in conditioned state. But as we keep reading, we'll actually understand that it's a really enlivening conversation. If you go to the last verse of this prediction, which he actually gives, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara. You remember when the first chapter, Gandiva, Arjuna actually threw it. What does Gandiva represent? Determination to practice Krishna consciousness. Determination to practice Bhakti Yoga. Any reversal that comes in our Krishna consciousness, we tend to drop it and we go on. So, but that represents Gandiva. That is represented by Gandiva, which Arjuna has actually given up. But after hearing Bhagavad Gita, Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara. Dhanurdhara means one who is wielding Dhanurdhara, which means he has picked up the weapon. Which means that whenever we have problem, if we turn to the pages of Bhagavad Gita, if we simply read the pages of Bhagavad Gita repeatedly over and over again, we will also see our determination is actually being upheld. Okay? Consistently. So it's important. Yatra Partha Dhanurdhara, Tatra Shri. Shri is opulence. Vijaya, victory. Bhuti. Bhuti is Vibhuti Yoga, opulence. Dhruva, morality. Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. Niti is morality. So wherever there is Supreme Lord, wherever there is Krishna, Tatra Sri Vijaya Bhutir Dhruva Nitir Matir Mama. Where there will be morality, there will be wealth, there will be victory. So this is how Sanjaya is actually concluding. In this section, you will also see Sanjaya says how, even though he was seated in Hastinapur Palace, how he is actually able to see what's going on in Kurukshetra war. Vyasa Prasadat, he says, like, by the mercy of Vyasadeva, he gets the divine vision with which he is actually able to see, okay, what was going on. Okay, so Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada ki. Okay, questions. We finally finished 700 verses. Any questions? Searching for keyword, Krishna Kumar. Yes.
You spoke about fanaticism and strictness.
Yeah.
So what is there's a very fine line between the two. So how do we know whether we be fanatic or...
Yeah. Once there was a disciple, Prabhupada was going on a morning walk, and one disciple comes barefoot. It's in Vrindavan. And Prabhupada calls him and he says, "Why are you coming barefoot? This material world is already austere. Why do you want to make it even more austere?" Okay, so the level of austerity, what is needed and what is not needed, that's given by the acharyas. We simply stick to their instructions. Scriptures as such has a very different range of instructions, something that is meant for different level of devotees. As far as ourselves is concerned, if we simply stick to the instructions of Prabhupada, how much ever Prabhupada actually says, what priority Prabhupada gives. Prabhupada says, okay, you do this much and then you continue doing service. And he said, like, no, I will extend my austerity. Unnecessarily just doing austerity just to boost our ego, they're all fanaticism. But if we simply stick to the pleasure of Prabhupada, simply stick to the pleasure, giving pleasure of Radha Gopinath, giving pleasure to the devotees, and simply stick to the standards that's actually given to Prabhupada, that is strictness. No matter what, we are still going to do. Like Prabhupada gives example, in the month of July in India, it is usually hot, but you still go to the kitchen and you still cook. So even to execute the instructions of Prabhupada, there is still some austerity there. So there we have to be strict. We should not give ourselves excuse. Of course, time, place and circumstances, but one's endeavor has to be strict. One day Prabhupada was sick, and then Prabhupada says, today I will take walking by driving on a car. So Prabhupada goes on a car. So like that, Prabhupada wanted to, like, you know, what's the point in sitting? I want to go out. So like that. So we have to do our best, basically. That's all. Someone else? What is the significance, meaning behind shaving one head? Well, once one reporter, Mataji, asked this question to Prabhupada. Prabhupada's immediate retort was, why do you shave your legs? And she was shocked and there was pin drop silence. And Prabhupada says, instead of having, what is it? Better to have a cool head than cold legs. Prabhupada says that. But Prabhupada then gives the answer that Vaishnavas, this is just a dead cell. Prabhupada says in Kali Yuga, hair is considered to be a sign of beauty. But Prabhupada actually says, we are Vaishnavas, we want to keep our bodily maintenance bare minimum. That's all. It's a very practical reason. It's in video interview also, if you see. One of the early interviews Prabhupada gave. Mayavadi and Brahmavadi, are they both same? Well, we discussed about this. Yes and no. So Mayavadi, Brahmavadi, both are impersonalists. Impersonalist means they don't believe that the Supreme Lord has a form. However, Mayavadi is convinced he is God. Brahmavadi is innocent. Okay, like a little child may actually think, you know, two times tables, that's the topmost level of mathematics. There is innocence there. So a Brahmavadi can be convinced easily. If when he actually gets exposed to knowledge, he will naturally elevate himself from impersonal to being personal. Whereas Mayavadi, he is convinced, Prabhupada says, Mayavadi, even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says actually, they are envious of Krishna, Brahmavadi is not envious of Krishna. Example of Brahmavadis is four Kumaras. We saw that example. Simply by smelling Tulsi, until that point they came in face to face with Vishnu, they thought, the Supreme Lord doesn't have a form. But as soon as they came in contact face to face with the Supreme Lord Vishnu, they are convinced, yes, he has a form. So that's the difference between Brahmavad and Mayavad. Both of them, they start at the same point, but Brahmavadi, when they are exposed to the knowledge about Bhagavan, they'll pick it up. In verse 67, it is mentioned that this knowledge should not be, I was expecting this, should not be explained to non-devotees, but we try to preach this knowledge to non-devotees. Can you clarify? Devotees are more merciful than Krishna. Short answer. So devotees, they give mercy unlimitedly. They don't show any discrimination. Okay, so if Prabhupada has actually seen that condition, we wouldn't be sitting here actually today. So we'll finish it today. Thank you so much for your kind attention, for coming. It's not over yet. I need 5 more minutes of your time. For coming, we always say, like, no, our attempt to preach Bhagavad Gita, to a certain extent, it was like, you know, a little stunted because of our own lethargy. We start, stop. We finished Gita in 19 weeks. Thank you so much. Wouldn't have been possible without your wonderful cooperation, consistency. And it's so important that we come together, we study Bhagavad Gita together. One devotee was actually telling me that, Prabhu, I've never read Gita like this. I was also telling, I also never read Gita like this. Always I go through. Today morning I was like, yes, 78 verses. I was just opening my room to go out. I was like, you know, sometimes you think, what chapter is it? Like that, even that I didn't remember. I was like, oh my God, if you're wondering why I came a little late today, that was the reason. I'm like, oh my God, I sent the notes also here. So the journey was really good, even for me also. So we prepared the notes if anyone is starting a class. So that's a perk, actually. If anyone starts the class, whatever we had actually discussed in this, I will provide the notes only if you start a Bhakti Sangha group or Bhakti Vriksha group. So that's an impetus for you. So you earn it. So I'll share the notes with you. You can take. Even if you had slept in class, don't worry, you can still make it. And the lectures, they're all available in YouTube. First 2 classes alone, we didn't, because that's how less we expected, actually, about the encouragement. But initially, first day, we were thinking we'll do in the meeting room. And then we thought, in the morning, I thought, what if more people come? So we said, like, okay, we'll just keep it in the temple room. But the numbers never dwindled. Thank you so much for encouragement. Different devotees are attending in Mayapur TV also, as well as in YouTube. We want to continue this question. Last week we were also discussing about how long we'll actually go. We'll keep on going until I drop down dead one day. So we'll continue. So after this, we are going to go with Nectar of Instruction. We'll go for, how many of you have read Nectar of Instruction? Okay, so Bhagavad Gita, one advantage of Gita is we have heard about Gita many times. We know what yoga is and everything, so we could rush. From now on, we'll go a little slow and we'll go a little deep. So the idea of Nectar of Instruction is we will finish in 4 classes in a month. Ishopanishad also after that we'll do. We'll finish in a month. And then, next we'll do Nectar of Devotion. That'll take 6 weeks. And Ishopanishad we will, can close Mataji. Now, Jai Shri Shri Radha Gopinath Bhagwan Ki. So Ishopanishad we'll do for another 4 weeks. So Nectar of Instruction for 4 weeks. Nectar of Devotion for 6, and Ishopanishad for another 4. I'm currently consulting with the different devotees. What's the best approach for Srimad Bhagavatam? I'll let you know in another 2-3 weeks time. Because each one of these, most of us are not as familiar as with any of these scriptures as we are with Bhagavad Gita, especially with Srimad Bhagavatam. To do justice to that, we need to, I mean, you can't really go slow. It'll become another Bhagavatam class otherwise. You know, one was a week, only 1800 weeks, you know, you need to 5 lifetimes or something, so it's not going to work. So I was discussing, even in our council, so most likely we'll go something like 15 to 20 pages, that's how much we'll actually be covering. If we go with that, I did a rough calculation, tentatively it'll come to 5-6 years, but in 5-6 years you would have read the Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam. Okay, one final request from my side, which I need. I've got some papers here. I need some feedback from you. 3 things mainly. Things which are positives, things you liked about it, what benefited. Second thing which is most important, you can skip the first ones, but second thing, areas where we need to improve. Okay, but one thing which I admitted repeatedly myself is, I know I was rushing Bhagavad Gita because as I said, our previous attempts has been kind of like jinxed. You start and then you stop. Few times we actually started over 15 years. Some places we managed to do, but it took like 6-7 years. We completely lost track where we started and everything. So that's why we wanted to go past this. And many devotees who are attending, they were also asking, how are you going to make sure that we'll stay inspired? I thought you should be asking that question to yourself. So we had few things to cover. So that's why we had to rush. So now we have set a good standard, set a good precedence. So now we can confidently, okay, go to the next book like that. So that's the idea. So areas where we need to, so that's a known feedback. But areas where we need to improve, that could be in terms of presentation, could be in terms of seating arrangement, could be prasad, could be anything. Okay, so that we need. Putting your name is optional. You don't need to. Okay, and if you have any other ideas, feel free to put it. Take 5 minutes and you can do. You can tear a piece of paper and you can pass it. Forgot to mention, you can tap one and you can pass it. This board has been kindly bought, transported and donated by Malobika Mataji. Let's chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra as a gratitude for that. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So basically positives, areas of improvement, and if you have any ideas. There's no Vaishnava Aparad here, by the way. You can say your class is boring, you can say anything. The idea here is, because it's going to be a lifelong journey, at least for me, so it's good to know. Among all holy scriptures, what is unique greatness about Bhagavad Gita? One thing that I can answer instantly is, all the other books were written by devotees about God, this is by God about God. So that's one thing that's very unique. This is the essence of all Vedic scriptures. If I neither friend nor a devotee to Krishna, what can I take from it? Good question. You can take the wisdom from it, definitely. You don't need to become a devotee of Krishna. You don't need to become a friend of Krishna. Krishna is the Supreme Father. Whether we love him or not, whether we take a shelter or not, he is the Supreme Father of everyone. We can treat Krishna for the person that he is. You know, somebody who is so elevated, somebody who is still showing so much humility, so we can learn all those wonderful divine qualities. Now, you can say that you are not a devotee or a friend. That goes to show that you are humble. You are actually a devotee. Otherwise, you wouldn't be even sitting here typing in Slido. Okay, so you are a devotee, whoever that typed that question. Okay, whoever in Mayapur TV and watching in YouTube, you can email me email me your feedback. Where are your papers? Okay, you can. Sorry, I'm taking a little longer today. We have come to a logical end, so before we go to the next one. Ishopanishad. Okay, next one, we are going to go with the nectar of instruction for 4 weeks. And then we'll go for nectar of devotion for 6 weeks. One of the classes during that time, Devamrita Maharaj has kindly agreed to come and give class there. But he'll be touching on NOD, but mainly he'll be talking on reading Srila Prabhupada's books. Then we'll go for Ishopanishad. Ishopanishad is part of Yajurveda. There are, I think 18 verses there. So this one we'll discuss for 4 weeks. So this is the order with which we are going to go in our scripture. Yeah. So next week onwards, we'll be studying nectar of instruction. Now, verses, if you read the verses we have been reciting, we have so far been reciting till 12, chapter 12. These two don't have many verses to memorize. So next week, I'll give you some verses that has a mix of nectar of instruction and the last 6 chapters of Bhagavad Gita. So by the time we finish Ishopanishad, we would have covered the rest of the verses in Gita, plus all the other scriptures also. Yeah. It may be even in the carousel, just in the foyer. There may be a copy available. It's just $2. You can get it. If any of you don't have a copy, you can grab a copy here if there isn't anything. Next week, I'll bring them. I'll bring. It's in the reception. Ketaki Mataji has kindly kept that for you in the reception. You can go there and you can get it. It's just $2. Ishopanishad, we don't have much stock. I'll order online and get them. By the time we go to Ishopanishad, I'll have them handy. Now for Bhagavatam, I'm placing a bulk order. We'll be following the material of Bhaktivedanta Vidyapit in Govardhanika village, Vada form. I will bring you some samples next week. You can go through them if you like it. You can give names and we'll order in bulk. So it'll be in time within the next 2 months for us when we actually start. That's the best study guide I have actually come to for an overview. If you want an in-depth study of each of the chapters, then Unveiling His Lotus Feet by Burjan Prabhu, by the same author as Sarandran to me, so there is a book. But Unveiling the Lotus Feet covers only the first 4 cantos. I think Prabhu is writing the next 4 now. Unveiling His Lotus Feet? Yeah, we have it. Yeah. So that's the plan. Okay, Lotus Feet. The other one is called Bhagavata Subodhini. I'll bring a sample. You can have a look. It's from Vada form. It's a study guide. It'll give a summary of the entire Srimad Bhagavatam. Whoever finished, you can pass it to me. And thank you.
This is the Bhakti Shastri course.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Bhakti Shastri. So there were some inquiries about Bhakti Shastri. We are starting a course in June. Abhishek Prabhu, Srivas Nitai Prabhu and myself will be running the course. That will be separated to scripture study. There is a commitment that's there. It's a 2-hour class every week. The class will go for 2 years. We'll go verse by verse in that. We'll go on for an in-depth study, but there's a commitment in that. Attendance is compulsory for that. There is examination, there is sloka memorization, there is assignment also after every module. There are 6 or 7 modules. We are sitting and writing the lesson plan now, but we'll start from 1st of June. I'll advertise that in Facebook. I'll email also, so you'll have the idea.
Do you have any idea when you'll put your class on, when you'll schedule it?